certified organic since 2003. Certified the property biodynamic in 2017, and most recently received the regenerative organic certification. The property itself is 280 acres. We have roughly 140 acres under grapevine. We try and be as far from a monoculture as possible. We like a shaggy vineyard. You know, we promote diversity here. When you're just growing one crop, you're trying to control nature and keep things out, and you lose control. I think much of France and much of the viticultural world moved to this monoculture 100 years ago, and they eradicated all these hedgerows. And it's fascinating to see them come here and how jealous they are of what we have and what we've kind of preserved. We'll employ a herd of 300 sheep to graze during the winter months. We have beneficial insectaries planted around the property to bring in all the good bugs. And we do everything we can to promote life, you know, and work alongside nature.
The natural enemies that we depend on to keep pests at, you know, manageable levels, they need things like shelter and nectar, alternative prey, pollen. Those often get encapsulated into that acronym SNAP, which is kind of fun. In general terms, the things that an organism needs from a landscape really vary depending on their particular biology, right? So some of that varies with how dispersive they are, right? So lady beetles that can fly a couple of kilometers are going to interact with landscape configuration and composition pretty differently from carabid beetles that maybe only fly a little bit and, you know, move a couple hundred meters over their whole lifespan. Top grassy strips used as beetle banks, perennial grass that doesn't get tilled up, is really important for maintaining ground beetles, a core population that can then disperse out into crop fields. And then there are organisms that are like predatory during all of their life stages, right? So all they're looking for is insects to eat the whole time, whether they're larva or adult. And then there are others like some syrphids, for example, where the larvae may be voracious feeders on aphids, but the adults need nectar. So incorporating annual floral resources into a crop field can be useful to an extent because it provides a pulse of resources that beneficial insects may be able to use, and then they'll prey on pests in the field. But that's just a temporary pulse of resources. So if there are ways to introduce beds of perennial and preferably native flowers that are diverse and long-lived, I think ultimately those are probably a better solution. If you have diverse floral resources, it means their bloom times are going to be overlapping and creating a timeline throughout the season where that resource is available to different natural enemies at different times. It's also available to a greater diversity of natural enemies.
Our main insect pest would be leafhoppers. I was on a conventional 3,000 acre vineyard, and leafhoppers were an afterthought. It was never anything we were concerned with. But when I got here, whole different ball game. I mean, it was to the point where, you know, we started defoliating in early August. All the products that are available to organic farmers in terms of insect control are pretty broad spectrum. You know, you can target those pests, but you're also going to be targeting all your beneficials as well. We're probably going into year 5 or year 6 of these perennial beneficial insectaries. It was around year 3 or year 4 when I started scouting the adjacent vineyard blocks and started consistently seeing lacewing eggs on the leaves. I guess it was testament to what we were doing was working to a certain extent, and I don't think we'll ever get full control of the leafhopper situation here. But as long as we're not defoliating in August, I'm okay with that.
Landscape composition and configuration both matter. They both matter a lot. The ways that they matter can be more context dependent, which crops, which pests, which natural enemies. But in general, landscapes that are more complex, have more natural habitat, and have more complex configurations and smaller fields tend to, in general, be more pest suppressive. Natural areas might be like very rectangular woodlots, or they might be conforming to physical geography and much more serpentine if they're following creeks and things like that. And so we can also quantify the complexity of those shapes. And that could conceivably have an impact as well on where edges are and how much edge there is per unit per area of crop field, and therefore the amount of spillover of organisms between those. And that could happen over different time frames, right? Where highly mobile organisms could move across edges, you know, within the course of a day or a few hours or a few minutes. And then it could also happen over longer timescales where, for example, maybe they find their overwintering shelter or their shelter from insecticide applications or something, and then they can gradually move into the focal crop over the course of it, like a season.
Jeff Landolt, who was managing Benzinger's operation, he brought me to the center of that farm, and you know, he just brought up looking at your vineyard from a bird's eye view and imagining it as a bicycle wheel. And in the center of that wheel, you have your hub, and that's where you put your perennials. From your hub, you plant your spokes. So that can be annual mixes, or you can start doing hedgerows. You have a population of beneficial insects that overwinters in the center of that property, and then by planting those spokes, you're giving them pathways or avenues to move out and into the vineyard. And the hope is that they're kind of hatching and doing their thing during the same time frame that your leafhoppers are. The perennials that are very successful on this property would be Toyon, Ceanothus, Coyote Brush, Coffeeberry. There isn't a month out of the year that you come onto this property and it isn't teeming with life.
Agricultural landscapes and agroecosystems feel like the place where there's just massive opportunity in terms of adding conservation value, because we haven't often thought of them as places where nature exists and depends on us, right? If we just think of them as places to grow food. But ultimately, those are places where we rely on biodiversity for all kinds of important ecosystem services. And where there's huge opportunity to design our farming systems and design our landscapes to house a lot more biodiversity and then benefit from it to build sustainable agricultural systems over the long term.
So if you're coming from like a conventional system, I always tell growers, the first thing is moving away from herbicides. That's like the biggest step anyone can take. As far as like the perennial insectaries, we started really small. We bought a couple plants of each to see what we felt like could work here. Another hard part for some property owners is adjusting this idea of aesthetics and what that piece of land should look like, right? When I walk into a vineyard that doesn't have weeds under the grapevines, I'm nervous. Once you're okay with that, once you've figured out how to farm without herbicides, I think the rest really will fall into place.